I want to introduce first today's lectures. Dr. Yamaguchi, Yamaguchi Sensei, will present nuclear safety. Sensei, please.
Hi. Hi. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today's my topic is nuclear safety. Safety is, of course, one of the most important topics for the nuclear community, right? And let me start the talk on the nuclear safety by the fundamental safety objective. And as you know, this is in the IAEA document, the SF1, fundamental safety principles, and it defines the safety as the safety objective, as the fundamental safety objective is to protect people and the environment from harmful effects of ionization radiation. So the purpose is we are looking at the people and the environment, both of them. But it added one more important sentence. This fundamental safety objective of protecting people individually and collectively and the environment has to be achieved without unduly limiting the operation of facility or the conduct of activities that give rise to radiation risks. So this is a very important sentence, but the problem is nobody knows what is unduly limited the operation and the operation of facility and the conduct of activities. So unduly is more a little bit ambiguous words. And furthermore, it said, to ensure that the facilities are people are operated and the activities conducted so as to achieve the highest standards of safety that can be reasonably achieved. So again, reasonably, this is very difficult word. What is reasonable? It's a problem. Okay? So, and measures has to be taken to control the radiation exposure of people and the release of radioactive material to the environment. This is a preventive measures. Normally, this is related to the normal operation. Okay? And to restrict the likelihood of events that might lead to a loss of control over a nuclear reactor core, nuclear chain reaction, radioactive source, or any other source of radiation. This is related to the accident conditions. And furthermore, to mitigate the consequences of such an event if they were to occur. This is a mitigation of the accident consequences. So these are the whole idea of the safety objectives. And let me say the risk triplet. No undue risk. In the US, the famous pioneering researchers on the risk analysis area, Stan Kaplan and John Garrick, they defined the risk triplet, recognizing that it is not possible to achieve absolute safety and zero risk, with benefiting from the while benefiting from the use of radioactive materials, terms such as adequate protection. The adequate protection is the expression used in the United States. It is equivalent to the regulatory requirement, mandatory requirement, and no undue risk are used. No matter an individual's preference for adequate protection or acceptable risk, assessment and the regulatory control will involve asking the same basic three questions, which are commonly referred to as the risk triplet. So they said the risk triplet are the three questions. What can go wrong? How likely is it? What are the consequences? So the first question is asking, what is the scenario that we are considering, evaluating? The second question is the frequency or a probability of an accident. And the third question is what is going on? What is the consequences if the accident happened? What is the health effect? What is the effect on the environment? These are the third questions. So anyway, when we discuss, talk about the safety, nuclear safety, we need to put the three questions in our mind. So try to answer to these important three questions. Let me reorganize the talk by now. Issues to be discussed is the how to achieve the safety objective without unduly limiting the operation or a facility or a conduct of activities. The unduly limiting is the phrase appearing in IAEA definition of the safety objective. What is the highest standard of safety that can reasonably be achieved? This is again from the IAEA documents. And it is not possible to achieve absolute safety under zero risk. Stan Kaplan and John Garrick said these words. That's why the no undue risk is their requirement in the United States. So the risk triplet pilot touch to the dialogue. Probably the risk triplet is very good material to have a communication on the safety or a risk. So here, we need to protect people and the environment. This is a safety objective. But achieve absolute safety and zero risk, this is impossible. But we'd like to achieve this one, zero risk or absolute safety. So in between the two ideas, the highest standard of safety that can reasonably be achieved. So we need to define what is the highest safety standard and what is a reasonable process, okay? So, considering these ideas in the early days, it is 1950, very early time of the nuclear development. The safety assurance relies on three Ds. At that time, there is no history of severe accident. So no one knows how likely is it. Answer to the question, how likely is it? Because there is no statistics, the no accident, severe accident. So they did not know the probability or the frequency of the severe accident. And some accidents are incredible and not worth considering. These are the conclusion in that time. So they neglected the very severe accident, and they claimed it's incredible. But no one knows what is incredible and what is credible, right? However, the addressing questions one, first question, it is scenario, and the third question, it is consequences. It is possible, but they used very conservative approach, like a large break locker. The probability frequency would be very, very small. However, they considered it will envelop all the spectrum of the accident. So the three Ds are determinism, design basis accident, and the defense in depth. So there is no concept at all about the probability or frequency or how likely is it. Just they decide the design basis accident and introduce the conservatism using the determinism. And then there is uncertainty, of course. They recognized the evaluation and the safety evaluation include essentially the uncertainty. That's why they introduce the defense in depth idea. If the first defense line is not successful, they prepare the second, third line, and the third, second defense line, and the third defense line, okay? However, this idea is based on the worst case thinking. So they need to define the worst case. So the problem is the worst case definitions. So what they did in 1960s or 1950s is the maximum credible accident. In old document in the US Nuclear Regulatory Commission, they define the maximum credible accident like this: accident which would result in the most hazardous release of fission product. That potential hazard from this accident would not be exceeded by that of any other accident. So that is a maximum accident, right? But credible accident. Whose occurrence during the lifetime of the facility would appear to be credible. So it is really a difficult definition of the maximum credible accident. And the severity of accident may vary depending on what we pay attention to. And it is not a straightforward problem to define the most hazardous scenario. Furthermore, one cannot prove the worst scenario is the worst. Maybe there is worse scenario than the worst scenario, right? I'll give an example on the first point. The severity of an accident, or otherwise the risk metrics, may vary depending on what we pay attention to. For example, this is a record of the occupational risks in coal mining in the United States, starting from 1931 to 2000 or something like that. This figure shows the three curves. One is the risks per 1,000 employee per year. The second curve is per million man hours. Third one is per million tons of coal mined. Those three are definitely an expression of risks. However, it depends on the efficiency or technologies or quality or sometimes regulation, right? So if we look at the per 1,000 employee per year, the risk looks like this. It looks very slow decreasing, right? However, when we consider the per million tons of coal mined, the decrease of risk is very, very good, right? Because the technology or a safety regulation has been improved during this period. I think we should use this one because our objective is to obtain coal from mine, and we are taking care of the health risks or health risks of employee. If so, per million tons of coal mined, this is the best expression of the risks, probably. Okay, let's go back to the nuclear. This is a schematic of the pressurized water reactor. Here, the reactor itself and the control rod. And yes, this is a primary system, and the steam generator, turbine, and the electric generator here. And of course, the containment vessel is shown here. And the yesterday, I talked about the three C's on the safety design. Nuclear power plant is mostly composed of two types. One is the parts required to generate electric power. This is a process system. And this system is enough to generate electricity. However, nuclear power plant have any other many systems. For example, here, reactor vessel, reactor core, this is important to generate power, right? Turbine is, of course, needed. Steam generator as well, primary system, secondary system as well. However, why do we have the containment vessel? This is the second type, parts strictly unnecessary to power operation. This is a safety system. And in a nuclear system, the safety system have three main objectives. It's a three C's. The first one is control power, the quick shutdown of the chain reaction. This is achieved by insertion of control rod in the reactor core, the control rod, or reactor scrum. Second one is injection of liquid neutron poison. Usually boron is used for this purpose. And this poison is put into the primary water and it circulates the reactor system, and the boron is a good absorber of neutron. So the reactivity in the reactor core will be reduced. That means the reactor power is decreasing. Okay, this is the first C. The second C is emergency cooling of reactor after shutdown. For this purpose, usually the nuclear system has a passive one and an active one. Accumulators is an example of the passive one. And high and the low pressure core injection system, this is the active system. And currently, the design by the provider of nuclear system, for example, AP1000, it has a passive water cooling system. And it has a water tank on the top of the containment vessel, right? However, the emergency core cooling system, the high-low pressure core injection system, this needs the electricity, power, and big pump. And those are necessary and active component. So the reliability of the system are relatively low. However, it is reliable. Reliable means certainly it can cool down the reactor system. The water flow rate is stable, right? The third C, this is the second C, cooling core. Third C is a containment of radioactive release from reactor. This is a confining or containing radioactivity. The special buildings in a PWR are used for this purpose, double containment design. And the internal reinforced concrete, it is pressure resistance, and also it includes the steel liner. This is leak-proof characteristics. And in addition, external reinforced concrete building. This is for further retention of radioactive products and the shielding from direct radiation and the protection against internal impact, external impact, okay? And in addition, engineering system is a part of the confining approach. Isolation valves, annulus kept negative pressure by filtered suction, and the spray and the cooling. So please look at these systems. Some are very essential for power generation, electricity generation. However, rest of them may not be needed. So it depends on the safety requirement or a designer's idea. And it is a famous that story that the old time, the Russian type reactor system does not have this type of the containment vessel, right? Because it is not essentially needed for power generation, but it is needed to protect people and the environment. So, considering these things, let me again look at the pressurized water reactor. Probably the equipment component surrounded by these red lines, these are necessary for power generation. But the rest of them is a safety system, and it depends on the concept of the safety design of individual reactor. Some design may have more additional system. Okay? Now, let's go into the detail of the three C's, safety system. Control power, cooling core, confining radioactivity. As I already mentioned, to control power, usually the control loads and the boron concentration, these are the measures to control power. And the cooling core, by steam generator in operation. This is a way to cooling the core in normal operation. Heat removal via the steam generators. and residual heat system, a heat removal system, and safety injection. This is the ECCS. And the confining radioactivity, usually the fuel cladding and the primary cooling boundary, and the containment buildings. These are three major physical barriers of the fission product release outside of the reactor system. Okay, this slide shows a very initial, old reactor, Chicago Pile 1. It is the leader of this project was Enrico Fermi, as you know. This is a world first reactor, and this gentleman is Enrico Fermi. And it includes very interesting SCRAM system. This one, SCRAM. It is said the origin of the SCRAM, the word, comes from Safety Control Lord Axman. You will see this guy, Axman. And in this system, this is a graphite blocks, including the cylindrical shape uranium fuel. And this one is natural uranium. You remember that if we have the graphite as a moderator, we can use natural uranium to get the critical. So this system has such one. The, when we read the paper, old paper, Enrico Fermi and his group put the graphite block one by one and measured the reactivity, if it is critical. But anyway, at the same time, they have the control power system. One is the cadmium rod. Cadmium is also the absorber of neutron. So if they inject the cadmium rod in the core, the reactor chain reaction will stop. And another one, the Oxman, he has an ox in his hand. And the absorber is pended by the rope. And if something wrong happened, the Oxman is ordered to cut the rope. And the control rod by gravity put into the reactor system. That is another way of the controlling the power in case of emergency. This is very original, old type SCRAM system, reactor control system. But anyway, current nuclear system has basically the same, based on the same principles. Inject the absorber in a reactor system. It may be liquid or a solid. It is inserted by gravity or a pressure or some other mechanical method. But anyway, controlling power is something like this. And my students were wondering why it said SCRAM. But textbook tells us that this is the reason why we say SCRAM, for the rapid injection of control rod system, the safety control rod Oxman. Okay? The second C is cooling the reactor core. Especially the decay heat removal is very important. And as you know, in Fukushima Daiichi accident, the reactor power control was successful. The reactor SCRAM took place after the earthquake because of the high ground motion acceleration. However, during the process of decay heat removal, the AC power was lost. So they could not use the active decay heat removal system. To make the things worse, the final heat sink, ultimate heat sink in Japan, it was a seawater system. And you know, tsunami comes to the reactor site, and the first system that is influenced by tsunami is the seawater system, because it is put in very close to the seashore, right? So in Fukushima, we lost the ultimate heat sink. At the same time, we lost the AC power. But we have to remove the decay heat shown here. This is a curve of the decay heat for the 2775 megawatt thermal nuclear power system. This is the 1 gigawatt, 1,000 megawatt electrical output, normal large-scale reactor. Even after the 100 second after the scrum, the decay heat is 3.5% of the full power. It's still huge power. Here is the example of the vaporizing water, and here at this level, we need to remove the 50 kilogram per second of the equivalent to the vaporizing the water. And even after 1 hour, it's more than 1%. And 1 day, about 0.5%. And 1 week, still 0.3 or 0.4%. So for the long time, we need to remove the decay heat. That's why passive system may be needed for the decay heat removal. The decay heat removal system should be reliable for long time period. It is not an instantaneous operation, but it needs to continue as we are working for 1 week or 10 days, right? So the reliability of the diesel generator system and the pumps continuously for 10 days will be less reliable. However, in this situation, the power level is relatively lower after 1 day, okay? So passive system may be appropriate to remove the decay heat in a reliable way. This is the second C. Okay, third C. This is the multiple physical barriers. From the beginning of nuclear power development, the engineers are very much concerned about the physical barriers of the fission product, because everybody knows in the reactor core, there are massive radioactivities inside. But it is very localized. All the fission product radioactivities is inside the fuel pellet or inside the cladding. So good idea is to put multiple physical barriers to contain the fission product. This is the idea. Then the first one is the fuel load and the claddings in here. The second one is a primary system. You know, in the PWR or BWR, the internal pressure of the primary system is very high. So that means the structural boundary of the primary system is very good quality, reliable. So the primary boundary works as the secondary barrier of the second barrier of the fission product. And the third one is the containment vessel. And in this slide, there it looks like many, many barriers, but essentially three barriers: fuel, primary boundary, and the containment system. Okay? Now, let me briefly explain the core and the containment cooling system. It includes many information, much information, but as I mentioned, in a reactor system, it is composed of the two types of systems. One is a process system. Second is a safety system. And this is an example of safety system. It is not needed for the power generation, but needed to achieve high quality, high level of safety. So it becomes such a complicated because the safety engineers want to put additional system. It's a redundancy. And the variety system. That means the various type of the cooling system is prepared, right? So this is an example of BWR, and you will see very much complicated. And also spray is here in the containment vessel and in the reactor vessel. And also water is injected via these pipes. Like this, the safety system becomes more and more complicated if we pursue higher reliability But please note that complexity sometimes may be worse. Simplicity may be good, right? So in a safety design, good balance of the passive system, active system, those are very, very important, right? And also, another important thing is a common failure, common cause failure. Even though we have many safety systems at the same time, but sometimes all the system may fail because of the same reasons. Earthquake is one of the such a event. If a huge earthquake comes on, the many structural boundary may be failed at the same time. This is a common cause failure. So if we prepare the several safety system, the mechanisms or a location or a manufacturers, those should be varied so that we can avoid the common cause failure. This is a very important idea in a safety design. Okay, this is a PWR. Again, you will see many, many systems appear, but it's too much to explain each of the system. But anyway, the active safety system looks like this, complicated. Many equipment are needed, and many support systems are needed to successfully remove the heat, right? Okay, now I talked about the 3Ds. In the initial safety design is based on the 3D approach, determinisms and design basis accident and the defense in depth. So how we can decide the design basis accident? What is a design basis accident? Usually in a master logic diagram is used to define the design basis accident, okay? And the design basis accident is the event which can define the capacity and the performance level of the safety system. As I already mentioned, the safety system is not needed for power generation. So there is no criteria or requirement to decide the performance level or capacity of the safety system. So design basis accident is used to define the capacity of the safety system. And we want to be complete to define the whole picture of the design basis accident. Then we use the master logic diagram. First of all, we define the target. We would like to prevent, avoid severe accident. This is the target, right? For the safety design. For this purpose, we consider what is the cause event coming to the severe accident. One is the insufficient reactivity control. If the reactivity in a reactor system is not controlled, the overpower may increase the system temperature, right? So this could be the first initiating event. And the second one, insufficient core heat removal. Even though power is controlled, but the heat removal could be sufficient. And insufficient coolant inventory. And insufficient coolant heat removal. And insufficient system pressure control. So this is within our capability to define these things. We can imagine that to prevent the severe accident, what is needed? Maybe reactivity should be controlled. Heat could be removed from the reactor core. Of course, the heat is transferred to the primary coolant system. So the coolant should be coolant inventory could be good enough. And also, coolant heat removal is necessary to control the system. Pressure should be controlled. Probably, this is good enough. And if there is needed more, we can add another initiating event. And we agree that these are the fundamental basic events. We can come to the example or a definition of the design basis event. For the anticipated, for the controlling the power, anticipated transient without scrum is used for safety analysis. Turbine trip without scrum or control load withdrawal. These are the examples of the failure to control the reactor power. About the core heat removal, maybe coolant pump trip would be a good example of this type. Coolant inventory, in this case, loss of coolant. Five break is an example of the loss of coolant scenario. And the coolant heat removal, loss of heat, feed water, and the coolant pressure control, failure to open safety relief valve, and the pressure could be raised, escalated. And I'll show the example of the safety analysis. Currently, relying on the good computer system and our knowledge on the thermal hydraulics safety, we have a good safety analysis program, computer program, to evaluate those scenarios. And this is explained what is happening, phenomena, in case of the large break rocker in PWR. This is the situation for the normal operation. And the coolant is circulating according to the red arrows. The coolant comes out of the reactor vessel to a higher temperature hot leg piping. And this is a steam generator and goes back to the reactor core. Via the downcomer, it circulates again the reactor core system. However, if the reactor system or a pipe break happened in this point, the pressure in here should be drastically reduced. So the water flows toward this break point. So the red arrow shows the change of the water flow directions. Reactor core, the water go toward the lowest pressure point. So all the water is going to go to the outside of the system, right? So in like this figures, the reactor core inside is vaporized and the cooling capability is deteriorated. But the emergency core cooling system works. Water is injected to the system again using the emergency core cooling system. This is a process of reflooding. And these are the typical thermal hydraulic phenomena in PWR. And the safety engineers have a good tools, computational tools, analyze these accident scenario, including the uncertainties. For example, this is an intermediate break rocker benchmark analysis. So many, many computer cores are applied to the same accident scenario, and they compared the result among the computer cores, which will tell us a kind of the uncertainty range of the safety analysis. In other words, it is a limitation of our knowledge on the safety or accident, okay? The primary pressure prediction is very good enough, is very good. All the computer code lies in a very narrow uncertainty range. And the break flow rate, the flow rate coming out of the primary system, it is also a good quality, right? Good agreement among the computer code. However, when we look at the liquid level in the upper plenum of the reactor vessel and the reactor core, and also peak cladding temperature, this is a very important parameter to define the fuel integrity. You will see many, the range, error range, uncertainty range of this analysis are relatively wide. So we should consider these uncertainties in a safety analysis. And like this, the reactor system, the safety analysis is performed, and the result is applied to the defining the capacity of the emergency core cooling system, for example, right? Okay, currently we have very good analytical tools like this, and all the accident scenario can be used, can be analyzed. And in many countries, they have their own computer code. So in the international conference, the researchers can exchange their technical information to improve their quality of the computer code and to understand the uncertainty of the analysis, which will be reflected on the safety design and the safety evaluation of the regulation or design. Okay, however, in the early time, we had no computational tools to define the accident consequence spectrum. I'll give an example of this type. In 1954, in the United States, Atomic Energy Act has been decided, yes, issued. At the same time, they need to define the accident damage compensation. So, Nuclear Indemnity Act is needed at the same time. What will happen if the accident occurs? And what is the maximum damage, economical damage, or a health effect if the severe accident happened? So, to answer to these questions, they tried to evaluate the accident analysis. As I mentioned, in 1950s, there is no PRA, probabilistic risk analysis, and they have no idea on how likely is it, probability or consequence of the severe accident. So it is based on design basis and the defensing depth. And of course, determinism is used, and conservative assumption is introduced to analyze the scenario. And needless to say, they recognize the uncertainty of science in the safety analysis. However, there is no quantitative methodology for uncertainty science. There is no way to quantify the uncertainty of the accident scenario. That's the problem. Then, Atomic Energy Commission started studies on potential accident consequence in 1956. This is a WASH 740, the famous report regarding the severe accident. And the title of this report is the theoretical probabilities and the consequence of major accident at large nuclear power plant. It's done by a Brookhaven people. And the report issued, published in 1957. Okay? The purpose is to understand accident risks and obtain technical basis for the Price-Anderson Act. They want to define the maximum damage of the severe accident for the primary Price-Anderson Act. What is the result of the simulation analysis? Not the simulation, analysis. The report says 3,400 fatalities, 43,000 injuries, $7 billion financial loss. It's huge, right? So they could not use the result for the Price-Anderson Act because the damage is too much. So they have decided to keep watching for more 10 years. Then September 2nd, in 1957, Price-Anderson Act, the assumed compensation limit is $560 million. It's much smaller than the $7 billion, right? And the expectation is that during the 10 years in the future, probably the knowledge and the safety analysis tools will be improved. If so, they can define the compensation limit using the updated WASH 740. However, what's happening is completely different, because in this time, 1960, US constructed a lot of nuclear power plant, and the size of the nuclear power plant getting larger and larger. So they have no way to invest their resources for the safety research. Then in 1964, AEC revised WASH 740, and the many considered the consequences should have been more benign. This is just an expectation. And the core melt initiated by a large local scenario resulted in 43,000 fatalities and the final financial loss several times larger, because the reactor size was larger in 10 years after, right? So there is no way to update the upper limitation of the accident damage. And the nuclear power plant power was larger, yes, but understanding of the mitigation effect by inherent mechanisms has not been improved and are not taken into account in the safety analysis. For example, the behavior of the fission product aerosols are not well understood at this time. Then the consequences are incredible. They expected the consequences are too much, incredible, but public are going to be anxious about the consequences if they publish the report. This is what happened. And no change of the upper limit of liability, and the Price-Anderson Act become effective as is, no change. And the major scenario is large local. This is substantially the most important design basis event. That is the story. So after that, actually, the United States, there are many, many discussions with the public, anti-nuclear group, about the uncertainty of the accident, consequence of the large break rocker. Then the regulators cannot answer to their questions. It is incredible, or it is very low frequency probability. So they have decided the decided to go into the probabilistic approach, okay? However, there is many uncertainties and no data, and it is not straightforward to use the probabilistic approach. However, the Professor Farmer in the UK, he published a farmer's curve. This is a safety goal. And the late 1960s, and the early 1970s were the glory years for nuclear power plant in the world. Many new reactors were built. However, there was no quantitative measure of public risk at that time. And the farmer proposed such a measure through a curve of probability versus consequences, with the risk defined as a probability multiplied by consequences. And the farmer recognized that while the public may well accept accidents that have a low frequency of occurrence, it might not accept accidents with very high consequence at an equal risk level. It's an idea of the risk aversion, right? If the consequence is higher, they will not accept the scenario. Thus, the high consequence accidents should pose a low overall society risks. So this is a farmer's curve. And the farmer's curve, he used this curve. The slope is one. However, he considered the higher consequences, the slope should be larger, minus 1.5, right? That means the curve can be given a slope of minus one for an equal risk for high consequence accident. It is minus 1.5. It is because of to have the public acceptance. This is the idea of the farmer. And this idea could be next lead to the probabilistic risk analysis. And again, I'll introduce an interesting message from Sir Thomas. It's an old physicist. And he said, I often say that when you can measure what you are speaking about and express it in numbers, you know something about it. But when you cannot measure it, when you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. It may be the beginning of knowledge, but you have scarcely in your thoughts advanced to the stage of science, whatever the matter may be. So he said the measurability is a very important idea in this case. And John Garrick continues his message, quantitative risk assessment. What we mean by quantification is still a bit of a mystery, as it depends on what we mean by measurement. Generally, what is meant is a figure or a number that indicates the amount of something. So you will notice that they are trying to answer to the question, how likely is it using the figure or a number? When we speak about the quantitative risk assessment of something, we are implying a process that results in a measure or indication of the amount of risk associated with that something. The interpretation provides visions of real numbers that indicate level of risks, such as the likelihood of different consequences, that is different outcomes of postulated risks. And postulated risks could be whatever we have fears of: automobile accident, fires, earthquake, climate exchanges, nuclear war, disease, severe storms. Everything is okay for the risks. Then Kaplan and Garrick proposed the probabilistic risk analysis approach. He tried to quantify the risk triplet question. First is the scenario, S1, SI. Second is how likely is it to happen. This is likelihood, PI. Third one is given that it occurs, what might be its consequences? This is consequence, XI. So he expressed the risk triplet by this equation, scenario, probability, and the consequence, combination of the three quantities. Then he proposed this approach. He ordered the scenario in increasing order, maybe, or a decreasing order, or plot the accumulation of the probability like this. For example, S1 scenario here, S2 scenario here. So it is a stepwise functions. However, they can draw the curves like this. This is very similar to the Fermat curves, right? Based on this approach, the famous research, WASH 1400 reactor safety study, this was done in 1975, led by the Professor Rasmussen. Okay? And in this slide, you will see the 100 nuclear power plant risk. Okay, this one is a fatality, otherwise consequences. This axis is a frequency or probability, right? And the 100 nuclear power plant in the United States risk is plotted by this curve. And in this report, they showed the other man-caused event risk at the same time on the same figure. This is a very good approach. However, it is misunderstood because public considered this figure want to say nuclear risk is much smaller than man-caused other risks. It is completely wrong. Reactor safety study did not want to compare the number of these curves. Important thing is the reactor safety study express the risk triplet, scenario and the likelihood or probability and the consequence. At the same time, they proposed what is the dominant component, what is the dominant action, what is a good approach to reduce the risk? Those information are very, very important. So anyway, this one is very pioneering, excellent work. And this is actually the start of the introduction of probabilistic risk analysis in a safety analysis and the regulation and the design. Currently, we have the level 1, level 2, level 3 PRA. In a level 1 PRA, we evaluate the core damage frequency, right? This is the first or second physical barrier. Fuel could be melt or damaged, and the reactor is seriously damaged, core damage scenario. This is a CDF. And it corresponds to the first physical barrier, yes. And the second physical barrier is shown here. This is a failure of the primary boundary and or a containment boundary. So, source storms maybe comes out of the reactor side to the environment, right? So in a level 2 PRA, large early release frequency of fission product is calculated. And also the source storm phenomena, source storm transfer, transportation is evaluated in level 2 PRA. And in level 3 PRA, they calculate the public risk, that is a physical health effect on public, and also the effect on the environment and the industry. So this is a typical approach of the PRA now. And let's go back to the master logic diagram again. I show a master logic diagram using the severe accident at the top event, right? But now we understand safety objective is to protect people and the environment. So, top event should be excessive off-site release of fission product. If we put this top event and we can develop the master logic diagram again, using these things, you remember insufficient reactivity control, insufficient core heat removal. This is just one part of the total master logic diagram. And in addition to the reactor severe accident, we may have the pressure boundary failure and the containment failure. These are the three physical barriers, fuel, primary boundary, and containment, okay? So with this, now we have the whole picture of the severe accident corresponding to the safety objectives, protecting people and public and the environment. Okay. This is just a picture from the UNSCARE report, and I have not discussed about the offsite phenomena. Of course, the reactor engineers are mostly interested in the reactor system response, but the level 3 PRA, we have to consider the public risk and the environmental effect, okay? So this report suggests we need to consider the transportation of the fission product in air or water or food and so on. But anyway, in a level 3 PRA, these things are evaluated in a probabilistic way. Of course, it is not a simple approach, difficult, and we need a lot of data, but this is probably the only approach to evaluate the public risk. Finally, I'll show the 3Ds again, the defense in depth and the design basis accident, okay? I have talked about the determinisms. Determinisms is good. It works. However, it is too conservative. So we introduce the probabilistic approach, PRA. So now we have the deterministic approach and the probabilistic approach. We can use both of them. How about the design basis accident and the defense in depth? Recently, the discussion in the international community have decided to introduce design extension condition. what is the design extension condition? Design basis accident is here. So maybe before boundary of the design basis and beyond the design basis was in here. However, we have learned the severe accident actually happened, right? Then we need to extend the design basis. That is the design extension condition. And in this design extension condition, we have two types, two categories, without significant field degradation, mostly field is intact, but it goes beyond the design basis boundary. Second type, with core melting. Here, the design basis is exceeded and core has melted. But in a safety design, these scenarios should be considered. That's why containment vest, reactor venting system and some other system are introduced to take care of the design extension condition. And this figure is the same expression, but you will notice the normal operation, anticipated operational occurrence, design basis accident. Yes, this is a design basis accident. This was the design basis accident. But now we have design extension condition. And they defined here conditions practically eliminated. It's a very important idea, but we probably agreed with that. Beyond the design extension condition, we have to achieve the safety objectives. So some accident that exceed the design extension condition should be practically eliminated. To achieve this, reactor system should be designed, operated, and managed. Like this, the red square is the old boundary of design basis. And currently, this black square is the new boundary of the design basis, right? Okay, it's almost the end of my talk. This is a famous picture of the UK health and safety executives' decision-making process about the ARAP, as low as reasonably practicable. And in this figure, they defined unacceptable regions in terms of the individual and the societal risks, and the broadly acceptable regions, and probably in between unacceptable and broadly acceptable, there is a tolerable regions. And we are going to make a decision in this range. However, as you know, there is uncertainties. So make a judgment if the scenario or an accident is tolerable or not. It is a very tough question and uncertainties. But to answer to this question, we have to rely on risk assessment. This is the only way to identify the whole picture of the accident scenario. But somebody says risk assessment, oh, it's okay, but do you have the complete data set? It is a very tough question, but we can answer. If there is no data, we may ask best available scientific knowledge. This is the best way to make a decision. And also best available scientific advice of the expert. But still, there is uncertainty. So residual risk management is performed by ARAP idea as low as reasonably practicable. In the first slide, I said reasonably achieved. This is the same idea. We have to consider what is reasonable, right? However, it is not completed. Then we can periodically check if the ARAP judgment at this point is good enough or not. Every some specific period, we review our judgment. This is a way of the safety analysis. And this is a summary. Safety objective is to protect people and the environment. It is not possible to achieve absolute safety and zero risks. And in early days, safety assurance relies on 3Ds and the maximum credible accident. Nuclear power plant is composed of process systems and the safety system. And the safety system is 3Cs. And the currently sophisticated safety analysis tools are available, but with uncertainties. So, how safe is safe enough? Or how incredible the consequence is? This type of questions is very important. And this question was raised, but no answer actually is given. Then farmers' curves and the PLA connect 3D's idea and the risk. That is the deterministic and the probabilistic. So the design basis is extended, design extension condition now. So we have to consider the severe accident directly in a design basis. And ARAP idea would be very useful, and it may answer to the question, how safe is safe enough? It is a good communication tool, and it's a good idea to communicate with the public. Okay, thank you for your attention. That's the end of my talk. And the question is welcome.
Thanks so much. Yamaguchi-sensei. So, thanks so much, including your history and approach and the initiative for the nuclear safety. So, are there any questions for Dr. Yamaguchi? Okay, okay. Please. Please, use a microphone.
Yeah, my name is Kalemets from Fermi. I have a question, 300. How much have you had time to look at the passive systems and from your professional interest, I believe, and also in perspective of Japan, because the designs that you introduced, they are old designs from last century, kind of look historically interesting to me, at least. But how much have you had time to look at this century designs?
What design?
Passive safety designs, yes.
What do you mean by the question?
I mean like AP1000, PBRX300, and designs like that.
By now, initially, the active system is mostly used. And after that, the passive system is introduced. But again, active system becomes popular. And now, AP1000 and the ESBWR mostly rely on passive system. And in the EPR, we understand it rely on mostly active systems, right? So still the passive and active system relationship will be open, and nobody has the definite criteria. And currently, in addition to passive and active, we have another concept, mobile and permanent. After the Fukushima accident or September 11th, incident, the mobile system were introduced. And again, we have the same question. How much mobile system will be introduced? And how much we should rely on the mobile system? So currently, the safety design, the concept is changing. Probably the design extension condition is introduced. Also, we have to define the practically eliminated. What is a practically eliminated? And in the IAEA document, it said if it is a passive system based on the natural mechanisms, it is practically eliminated. But probably nobody have the definite answer. And when we look at the current designs of nuclear system, all the system have the mixture of those ideas at the same time. So I'm not sure I can give you a clear and a definite answer, but the essentially, it is a problem of no answer, like uncertainties. Are you satisfied with that?
It will be proven through licensing.
Yes, yes. And also designers. But I can say that some designers claim the passive system is very reliable and good, but it depends. Of course, passive system works, but the regulators should look at carefully the strongness and the weakness of the passive system, active system. Okay.
Okay, are there any more? Yes, please.
Thanks for the very good lecture. So my name is Imo Puska, I'm from Environmental Board. I have a question about the security part, because we're talking about accidents, and for the beginning you mentioned nuclear war, which is more a security event than an accident, and now we're talking about the war in Ukraine, and terrorism, and so on, and when those kind of risk assessments are taken into account in the design phase, or will be done later? Thanks.
Yes. It's a very recent topics, and I know several research institutes are trying to do the security risk assessment. But in reality, the security information is not open to us, and not easy. But the when we talk about the nuclear safety with the PRA people, they said the Chernobyl accident was mostly caused by safety culture issue. Three Mile Island accident is mostly human error. Fukushima accident is natural event. And we agree that if something happened next, it is would be a man-made event, like security or terrorism risks. But I'm sorry, I have no experience of the security risk analysis. I may follow the activity if it's open, but probably it's very maybe difficult to discuss in open conferences in detail about the security risk. It's very specific to plant and the owners and the regulators. Yeah, but you are right. Security risk, we should take care much more.
We have the title of the nuclear security. Afternoon session by the Ms. Noro-san. Mm. So please make your question again to Mr. Ms. Noro, okay?